So, part two, as Linux policy administration, policy language. So in this part, we're just going to take a look at the policy language, the ways that we can instruct as Linux to enforce our policy. The first and most important aspect we're going to discuss is the access vectors. And we already discussed that in the previous chapter. To quite some extent, but like access vectors are like are a fundamental part in security policy language. It's basically always part of a rule or of a rule or a constraint, or it's always there. It's used. It's provided by the object managers. It's not something we can manually edit. We have to deal. The object managers tell us, okay, this is a object of this class, and these are the ways one can operate or interact with it. And those are the facts, and we can use those access vectors to specify whether some identifier is that we create is allowed to do that or not. So security classes and access vectors, access vector permissions, is what this slide is called. Language and concepts that can be used to instruct SE Linux to enforce policy. So that's the policy language main introduction line. So a security class or an object class plus a set of access vector permissions equals access vector. So an access vector is a combination of an object class and a set of permissions. Now, in the previous example, I already showed you SE info xc and then less. First of all, let's just show you all the object classes or the security classes. It's just what how you want to call it. So here are 83 security classes provided by the various object managers on the system. These are basically classifications for kinds of objects. So you have, for example, file objects, directory objects, socket objects, pipe objects, but you have also packet objects, node objects, character file objects, block file objects, message queue objects, and you name it. There's shared memory objects, key objects, password objects, context objects. There are very many objects, and there's actually a object reference available on the internet, because I can imagine that you see these objects and you just say to yourself, okay, what is a Netlink audit object? And actually, to be honest, the object classes reference that I'm about to show you, I guess, doesn't actually explain what that object really means, but just explains what the permissions mean, that the access vector permissions mean that you can use on them. So let's just have a look at that. OSS trusses.com projects ref policy, and then there's OSS trusses projects, then there's a reference documentation page here, and then there's a link to object classes perms, and that links to the slinksproject.org site. And here you have basically the explanations. So for example, the database object class has a bunch of access vector permissions, and then you can basically, let's just, yeah, I could show you that in the list. So less, and then go to, actually XC to expand them, and then go to database here. No, this is database procedure. Where is the database? And it's probably all the way down in the list. And there's no way to grab it. Oh, that's actually that's not the right. These are common to all database objects. So we use some inheritance mechanism, because all database objects inherit some basic permissions, I guess. That's not quite true either. But anyways, this reference link explains what the permissions mean for particular objects. So for files, for example, the append permission means to write to a file opened with the o_append. So you probably need to be a programmer to understand what it means to open a file with o_append. But at least this will give you some indication. IPC, now destroy means destroy, yeah, okay. Some of these descriptions aren't as descriptive as possible, as could be, but at least there is some reference there. But what exactly the object classes mean, that isn't really described properly. But anyways, the combination of object classes and the permissions that can be used to operate or interact with them are called object access vectors. So here you have the object classes, 83, and here you have the object classes with the available access vector permissions for each object class. So your object class TCP socket can append, bind, connect, create, write, and then you could use that to actually use a reference to see what that actually means to some extent. But still, you'll have to know at least know what these objects mean, these object classes, what a message queue is, what an X property is, for example, which means you basically need to be an X server specialist, I guess, or know what a DB procedure is. Well, I guess you need to be a database expert to know what a database procedure is. So yeah, it requires pretty much specialized knowledge to actually know what a particular object is, and know what it means to interact with or operate on a particular object class in a particular way. So object vectors are provided to us by object managers. So the kernel object manager provides us with kernel access vectors, and for example, the database object manager provides us with database access vectors, and the dbus object manager provides us with dbus access vectors, etc., etc. So here it is. Kernel object manager classifies kernel subjects and objects and access vectors that can be used to interact with and operate on subjects and objects respectively. So here it's where I'm underscoring it. Access vectors are the core security attributes, and that's quote unquote, of SE Linux policy enforcement. Basically, objects of access vectors are basically the core of most policy rules. You always need to specify the access vectors if you want to specify a particular rule. So here's a simple access vector, a message object class, and then the permissions inside the brackets are send and receive. So you can actually send and receive to message object classes. Those are the two ways you can basically operate on message object classes. And then you can use those to allow some source type identifier to either send or receive messages to some specified target type identifier using type enforcement and the access vectors. We'll get into that a little bit later, I hope. So that's basically it. The main takeaway here is access vectors are a combination of object classes or security classes and access vector permissions. And the access vectors are provided to us by the object managers. And the access vectors are the core elements of the rules that we write. We use those access vectors in almost every rule that we write. So let's have a look at the policy language. So identity-based access control statements. So the identity-based access control security model has a single statement, and it's called the user statement. And the user statement allows us to enables us to declare identity security identifiers. So we can create identity security identifiers and to associate existing role security identifiers and to optionally associate existing sensitivity and existing category security identifiers or ranges thereof to the identity security identifiers. Because sensitivity and category security identifiers are optional, so that's why I'm saying optionally associate existing sensitivity and category security identifiers. Because yeah, if you don't use them, if you don't have MLS or MCS, then obviously you won't associate those identifiers to security identifiers, which are always there because IBAC is a default security model. So, but these role and sensitivity and category security identifiers need to be existing. So you can't associate a role identifier if it doesn't exist. So it needs to be existing, and same for the sensitivities and compartments, categories. So there are some keywords in this statement. The keywords user, role, and then optionally level and range. So here's an example of such a statement, of a user statement without MLS or MCS security model. So basically what it does, it declares a user identity security identifier with the name of user underscore u, and then it associates the user underscore r existing role-based access control role security identifier to that user. So it's an association between the user role and the user U identity, user identity, so to speak. These underscore R's and underscore U's basically is an indication for us to determine whether it's an identity or a role. So you note here that it's a U for identity. Some people call identities users, but I prefer identity. So in my case, I would probably use user underscore I instead of user underscore u. So that basically creates a identity called user underscore u and associates the existing user underscore r role to that identity. And here I have another example. It declares the sysadmin underscore u identity identifier, and then assigns the sysadmin underscore r role identifier to the sysadmin underscore u identity identifier, and also assigns a level of the lowest sensitivities S0 and a range of the lowest sensitivity to the highest sensitivity. In this case, S15 is the highest sensitivity, at least in stock policy. It could be S100 in theory, but in common policy, S15 is used as the highest sensitivity in the hierarchy. So it's a range of sensitivities that are associated to the sysadmin U identity, and a range of categories that is assigned to the sysadmin underscore U identity identifier, which is the full range in stock systems. normal systems have 1024 categories, so this user is assigned the full range of categories as well as the full range of security levels. So can also be declared manually with the SE-manage utility. So we'll get into that later, to the SE-manage utility later. But you can specify, you can create these mappings, these associations, declare these identities using policy language, but also use the SE-manage command to create them. So that's basically the only IBAC statement that's there. Role-based access control statements. So role statements. So the role statement enables us to declare role security identifiers and to optionally associate existing type security identifiers to existing role identifiers. So yeah, it's a long sentence, but I really want to make clear when something is optional and when existing identifiers are required and stuff like that. So let's have a look at this. The keywords are role and types. So here are some examples. So how to declare a new role identifier, security identifier. Basically just use the role keyword and then the role security identifier that you want to create, that you want to declare. So the second example basically associates a existing role identifier to an existing type identifier. So again, the role in this second statement, the role identifier must exist and the type identifier must also exist. So you need to declare the role first, like we did here in this example, and then use this statement if you want to associate the specified role to a specified existing type. And then here's another example which goes a little bit beyond the scope of this slide, but you can also use what's called role attribute security identifiers, which basically used to group role security identifiers to basically associate groups of roles, a group of roles to a group of existing roles to existing type security identifiers. So that's basically why there's a my user underscore roles rather than a user R. This is a single role and this is a set of roles. All right. So that's basically the role statement. So can only associate existing role security identifiers to existing type security identifiers. The last two, I guess. Yeah. So, and that's basically what I mentioned. So that's basically the roles. Those are the role statements that you can use. Oh, actually, there's more. So we have more role-based access control statements, but this was the role statement. This is an attribute role statement. So this is a different kind of statement. The attribute role statement was introduced in policy version 26. That's pretty recent. Well, not that recent, but pretty recent. So it enables us to declare role attribute security identifiers. So that's just really simple. You can declare a role attribute security identifier. Role attribute security identifiers can be used to group role security identifiers. So I briefly mentioned that in my previous slide. So you can basically create or declare a role attribute security identifier, then associate that to role security identifiers, and then use the role attribute security identifier to write rules that apply to sets of role security identifiers rather than individual security identifiers. So role attribute security identifiers enable us to refer to a group of role security identifiers rather than individual role security identifiers. But we'll get to that later. This statement, this attribute role statement, just allows us to declare a role attribute identifier. And it's really simple: keywords, attribute, role, and then you just need to specify a name for your role attributes identifier. In this case, in this example, I just create a new role attribute security identifier called user roles, and then I could basically assign that role attribute security identifier to all roles that are roles for users, for example. But that's a little bit beyond scope. Alright, so the other role-based access control statement, called a role attribute statement, also introduced in policy 2026, policy version 26, pretty recent, enables us to associate existing role attribute security identifiers to existing role security identifiers. So here's where you actually associate the role attribute security identifiers to existing role security identifier. So basically where you add a role security identifier to a group of role security identifiers. Role attribute security identifiers can be used to group role security identifiers. Yeah, we said that in the previous slide as well. Role security identifiers enable us to refer to a group of role security identifiers rather than individual role security identifiers. We said that as well in the previous slide. And the keyword is role attribute. So here's what you get: role attribute, and then you specify a existing role security identifier, and then you specify the existing role attribute security identifier that you want to associate to the existing role security identifier. So here we basically associate the user underscore roles existing role attribute security identifier to the existing user underscore r role security identifier. And this basically, you'll have to look at this as tagging. Like, you can tag your websites, for example. This website is an SA Linux website, so I put the SA Linux tag in the Firefox tags, and then if I want to see all the SA Linux websites, I can just open all websites that have the SA Linux tag associated to it. And that's the same with attributes. Basically, it's a way to group security identifiers, in this case role security identifiers, so that you can write rules that apply to all security identifiers associated to a role attribute security identifier rather than a single role security identifier. Just makes it easier and more readable, clear, stuff like that, compact. So role-based access control rules. So we had the statements, but role-based access control actually also provides us with rules. We can specify rules, and this rule is called the role allow rule. And the role allow rule enables us to determine whether specified existing role security identifiers can manually change to other specified existing role security identifiers. And the keyword is allow. So here we have a rule that says allow the staff underscore r role security identifier to change manually to the sysadmin underscore r role security identifier. And so this rule is basically used to allow users to manually change from one role to another. But of course, there are then, if you specify this rule, then you need to take into account that some prerequisites must be met. The IBAC user statement prerequisite must be met, because the user identity must have access, must be associated to both the roles, the role to change from and the role to change to. So this, because if not, then it won't, then this rule won't work. Because to be able to use the role, it must be associated to the identity. And the rollback role statements. So yeah, the roles must exist, obviously. And the roles must also be associated to types for this to happen. But once you the prerequisites are met, then this role allows a particular identity to change from one role to another manually. with, for example, the new role command, or the sudo command allows you to change roles manually as well if you have the required permission to do so. And this is what this is part of the permissions that enable you to allow that. So if role security identifiers have to transition automatically, then additional role transition rules must be specified. So this is just to change manually from one role to another. But if you want to change automatically using a role transition, which we'll discuss later, then you'll additionally need to add a role transition rule so that an automatic role transition can take place. We'll talk about that later, probably next slide or something like that. Yeah, so here's another role-based access control rule. It's called a role transition rule. So it enables us to specify automatic role security identifier transitions from one existing role security identifier to another when the process executes a file with a specified existing type security identifier. So this depends on type enforcement as well. So instead of basically allowing someone to manually change roles, you can also automatically change roles by transitioning. And transitioning happens on executing files. So for example, you can specify, and here's another one. So transitioning happens on executing files, but for a transition to work, the executable file must reside on a file system mounted without the no SUID option. We see that often, that transitions don't happen for some kind of stupid reason, and then it turns out that the executable file resided on a file system that was mounted with the no SUID option. But for transitions to work, no SUID must be allowed. So keep that in mind. That applies to all transitions, not just role transitions, also type transitions, at least process type transitions. So yeah. Anyways, the role transition has one keyword. Role transition rule has one keyword, which is role transition. So here's an example of a role transition rule. So this rule says automatically transition from the web admin underscore R role, the existing web admin underscore R role, to the existing system underscore R role when a file with a type security identifier of httpd underscore init rc underscore exec underscore t is executed. So here you have a shitload of dependencies, prerequisites for this to actually happen. One of the dependencies is the IBAC user statement, because you're changing roles. So you must have access to both roles, the existing role, the web admin role, as well as the system R role, because you can't change or transition roles if the roles aren't associated to your identity. Then you have the role statements. The roles must obviously exist, else you can't use them. So you need to declare the roles that you're using and also associate those roles to types. And then you need to have the role allow rule. So you need to actually allow web admin to manually change to the system R role. So allow web admin as system R from our previous slide. You need that. And then of course you need the type enforcement type statement. This type actually must exist and must be associated to the file you want to transition to use to transition. And then you also, a prerequisite is the type enforcement access factor rules, which you need to be allowed to execute the file with the httpd underscore init rc underscore exec t type security identifier to be able to transition, because the transition happens on execute. So you need to be allowed to execute that file, and that's done with type enforcement access factor rules. So yeah, there are a shitload of prerequisites for a role transition to happen. So let's go on to the type enforcement statements. This is the type statements. These are the type statements. Enables us to declare type security identifiers and to optionally associate local existing type attribute security identifiers and local existing alias type security identifiers to type security identifiers. Wow, that's a long sentence. But yeah, I really want to mention the corner cases, the optionally and local and existing. That's just important to mention. That's why the sentence is so long, because it needs to be that and nothing else. So anyways, it has two keywords, type and alias. The alias keyword is optional. So to declare a new type security identifier, simply use the type keyword and then the type security identifier that you want to declare. So user T is declared here for use. So declare a new type security identifier and associate that to existing type attribute security identifiers, a fire called user types, this is used. So it declares a new type security identifier and associates that type security identifier to an existing and local type attribute security identifier called user types. So basically we're grouping this new user T type to the user types existing local user types group. The third basically declares a type security identifier called user underscore T and makes the existing my user underscore T type identifier an alias of the user underscore T type identifier. So basically the same, just a different identifier, but it's an alias of the user T of the created user T identifier. So that's basically an alias. And yeah, you don't often use aliases, but it can be handy if you basically deprecated a type identifier. Then you can sometimes it's handy to make an alias of another type identifier. And the last one is actually a combination of associating an alias to an existing alias to a new type security identifier, and to associate an existing local type attribute security identifier to a new type security identifier called user T. So it does it all in a single line. Group it and alias it, or alias to it. So yeah, that's the type statements. And obviously there are some prerequisites here as well, because if you want to basically associate a new type, create a new type and associate that to an existing local type attribute security identifier, then the type attribute security identifier must obviously be declared. And I'm not sure if this actually also declares it. I think you need to actually declare this type attribute security identifier before you can actually assign it to a type security identifier that you're creating. So yeah, it's pretty pretty complex in that regard. So the attribute statement is another type enforcement statement. Enables us to declare type attribute security identifier. So this one is pretty simple. Type attribute security identifiers can be used to group type security identifiers. So it's basically the same as the role attribute security identifier, but then for types. Type attribute security identifiers enable us to refer to a group of type security identifiers rather than individual type security identifiers. So yeah, we can write rules that refer to a group of type security identifiers rather than a individual type security identifier. That can be handy if you have some event that applies to more than a single type security identifier. Then you can just use the type attribute security identifier to allow that in a single rule. So the keyword is attribute. So what you do is basically use the attribute keyword and then just use a string that you want to use as a type attribute security identifier. So in this case, user underscore types is a to be created type security attribute attribute security identifier, blah blah blah. So it creates a new type attribute, I guess. The type attribute statements. So this one enables us to associate existing type attribute security identifiers to existing type security identifiers. So note here that I'm not saying local. So here you have the same preach. Type attribute security identifiers can be used to group type security type attribute security identifiers can be used to group type security identifiers. Type attribute security identifiers enable us to refer to a group of type security identifiers rather than individual type security identifiers. So the keywords, or the keyword is type attribute, and here are some examples. So here you have type attribute user T and then user underscore types. So basically what it does, it assigns the user underscore types type security identifier to the user, to the existing user T type. Now the nice thing is that they both do not have to be local. You can just basically import those identifiers and then just use them, whether they're local or external, that doesn't matter. And we'll get into the concept of local and external later, but the type attribute statement is basically the same as, kind of the same as the statement in the previous slide, except that we can now associate identifiers, type attribute and type, type attribute identifiers to type identifiers, whether they're local or external. And here you have another example which basically associates various type attribute identifiers to a single type identifier. So the user types and the process types type attribute identifiers are both associated to the user underscore T type identifier in a single statement. So the type alias statement enables us to associate existing alias type security identifiers to existing type security identifiers. So again, this is, note again, that I don't mention local, because with the type statement we were able to associate local existing alias types to type identifiers, and now we can, with this type alias statement, we can basically associate existing external or internal, whether you whatever you like, but also external type security identifiers, alias them to a specified existing type security identifier. So assigning external type identifiers rather than local identifiers. So here's another example where you assign two existing external type security identifiers allies them both to the user, the existing type security identifier. We use brace expansion to basically allies them both to the user, the type security identifier. Aliases aren't used often, so you won't be using this much. But it's handy, it could be handy. And it's just so that you know. Alright, so another type enforcement statement is the permissive statement. So this one was introduced in, I think, policy version 24, I'm not sure. It's been there for a while. This statement enables us to exempt specified existing type security identifiers used for subjects from policy enforcement. So that's a long line as well. So types that are used for processes can be exempt from policy enforcement if you declare them to be a permissive type security identifier. So basically, we haven't talked about permissive mode yet, but permissive mode is a mode of apparatus for SE Linux, where it basically SE Linux is in what's called a host-based intrusion detection only mode. Basically, it doesn't prevent events that aren't explicitly allowed. It just logs that it would have prevented it if it was in prevention mode. But that's the permissive mode for SE Linux is that's on a system-wide level, so that basically applies to all the process type security identifiers rather than a single one. So the permissive statement allows you to make a single type security identifier permissive rather than the whole system. And this can be useful, although I must say in practice I don't use it that often, because events involve sources and targets. When you interact, you have a source and a target. And if you make the source process type permissive, then that's no guarantee that it just works, because if the target type is still enforced, then the target type might not be able to, for example, answer a question that the source asks to the target. So for example, if you with dbus, where someone sends a message over the dbus to a target, and then you make the source type permissive, then the target might not be able to answer, and then still the source will still fail, because, well, it didn't receive an answer to a question that it wasn't expecting, and so shit hits the fan. So it's not really that super handy. It's nice to have, but it's not that super handy. So it puts the single specified type existing type security identifier in intrusion detection only mode rather than intrusion prevention mode. So it will log would-be denials, would-be preventions, but it doesn't actually prevent it if you declare the specified existing type security identifier to be permissive. So the keyword is permissive, and then basically you just type the keyword permissive, and then the type security identifier that you want to make, the existing type security identifier that you want to make permissive. So you really need the type statement for this to work first, because the type must exist before you can actually make it permissive. So it can also be exempt manually with the SEManage utility. So yeah, that's right. So you can also use the SEManage utility or tool to create or to declare existing types permissive. We'll get into that later, I guess. So type rules. This is, I guess, the first type rule that we are going to discuss. It's the type transition rule. And the type transition rule can be split up in two kinds of type transition rules. You have a domain type transition rule, which you could actually call a process type transition rule, and a file type or an object type transition rule. Because files and processes are kind of different, in the sense that a process is an active entity, while where a object is a passive entity. So that's why we split the type transition rule up into domain type transition rules and object type transition rules. So let's just talk about the domain type transition rule first. So it enables us to specify automatic process type security identifier transition from one existing process type security identifier to another when the process executes a file with a specified existing type security identifier. So it's an automatic transition from one type to another where they're both existing types, and type transitions happen on execute. So again, the file system where the executable file resides that you use to transition on must reside on a file system with the no SUID option not used, because no SUID is needed, or isn't SUID isn't needed. You can't transition with no SUID. Sorry, that's very confusing. No SUID prevents the transition to occur. Like, let me tell you like that. Anyways, the keyword is type transition. So this is an example of a type transition, or a domain type transition. So here's the type transition keyword, and then it says transition from the existing user underscore t type security identifier to the user underscore app underscore t type security identifier when the app underscore exact t type file is executed. So there's a file with a type app underscore exact t with the existing type at type security identifier app exact t, and this rule says okay, only transition from user t to user app t if this file is executed. Now there's a shitload of prerequisites, needless to say. IBAC user statement, let's see why that is required. Well, actually, yeah, of course that's required, because users must be associated to user identity. So in that sense, the IBAC user statement is obviously required. This is a user process. Role-based access control role statements. Yeah, so the role associated to the user identity must have access to the target and also the source, of course. Type identifiers, if the role is not associated to the type security identifier, then stuff won't work. And then type enforcement statements, yeah, because we said that these type security identifiers must be existing, so you need type statements to declare the types before you can actually use them in a type transition statement. So that's why TE type statements are a prerequisite. And finally, TE access vector rules are a prerequisite, because to transition from one process type to another, you must be allowed to execute the executable file that is specified here with the application executable file type. So you must be allowed to do that, and that's allowed with type enforcement access vector rules. So yeah, those are prerequisites. I might be overlooking some prerequisites. The point that comes across is that it's all associated. All these security models, all these identifiers, they're all associated, and they all have prerequisites that you need to think about. So the other type transition rule is an object type transition rule, and objects are passive entities as opposed to processes that are active entities. So enables us to specify automatic file type or object type security identifier transition from one existing object type security identifier to another when the process creates specified objects in a directory with a specified existing type security identifier. Another mouthful, but yeah, I really want to make clear about the prerequisites. So it must be a, we'll get into that later anyways. So object type transition happen on create. So where process type transitions happen on exec, when you execute a file, object type transition happen when you create a object. So the keywords are type transition, just like the process type transition. So here's some examples. So here's a type transition. So the type transition statement. So it says when the process with the process type user underscore t creates a file in a directory with an existing file type security identifier of user home dir t, then transition from user home dir t file type security identifier to the user underscore home t file type security identifier. So, yeah, the directory where the file is created in must be labeled with the user home and their T type security identifier, which is a must be which is existing, and the target type is also existing, and the source type is also existing. So it's all existing, and it only happens on the file or object class. So it only happens if there's a file created. If it would be a dir, for example, then this wouldn't apply because it only applies to files. So here you have another example. So here's a type transition that says tells SE Linux, okay, when a process with a process type security identifier of user underscore t creates either a dir, a file, or a link file in directories with type user home dir t, then type transition from user home dir t to user home t. So all the types must be existing types. But the difference with the above rule is that this type transition rule does not just apply to files, it also applies to dirs and to link files, symlinks. And here you have another possible type transition rule for objects. So this one tells SE Linux, okay, if a process with a process type of sysadmin underscore t creates a file in a directory with a type of etc t, and if that file has a name of resolve period conf, then type transition from etc underscore t to net underscore conf underscore t. So here you have actually a name also. So it, the type transition rule only applies to files, but also only if that file has a name of resolve.conf. So it allows some extra flexibility here. For example, if you want to transition object type transition to various different types in a with the same object class in the same dir, then you can use the name to specify, okay, if the name is that, then transition to that type, and if the name is this, then transition to this type. So this one is very useful, I think. It's pretty new, the named type, file type transition is pretty new. It's not available in the Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, so that's just a note. So, and this is what we refer to as a named file type transition rather than a usual file type transition. So prerequisites, TE type statements, yeah, because the types used in these type transition rules must be existing, so they must be declared with the type statements. And TE access vector rules, yeah, so because to be able to transition, you must create a file, because the transition happened on create. And yeah, you must allow the creation of the objects using TE access vector rules. So that's another prerequisite. So that's basically type transition rules, object type transition rules, and process type transition rules. They're kind of different in nature because of processes are active entities and files are passive entities. All right, so another type enforcement rule is the type change rule, and I'm going to go over that really quick because that's not often used. So enables us to specify whether a process with a specified existing type security identifier can manually change the specified existing type security identifier of specified objects to other specified existing type security identifiers. Phew! Used by SC Linux aware applications. So that's a thing to know. This type change rule is needed for applications that are SC Linux aware, that basically explicitly change types manually. Just like with roles, you can actually also change roles manually. I explained that in the role rules. You can also change types manually. Programs can do that manually. And that requires a type change rule. So anyways, the keyword is type change. So here you have some example, a type change, and then tells SC Linux, okay, when PTI helper underscore T process allows or tells SC Linux to allow PTI helper underscore T process type to change from dev PTS character files to user dev PTS character files from one type to another, from the dev PTS to the user dev PTS if it's a character file. But the actual change happens using lib SC Linux functions, like using SC Linux functions called by SC Linux aware applications. So, but this just allows it. So the prerequisites type statements, the types must be existing that you use in these type change state rules. What is it? Yeah, type change rules. And TEAV rules, yeah, so I'm not sure here, but I guess there are probably some TEAV rules requirements involved here. I'm not sure which one. And here you have some of these SC Linux library functions that that is a prerequisite. So the application must use the security compute relabel, the SC Linux library function to actually relabel it, and then this rule must be there to allow that. So, but it's not often used. It's used by login applications. By, for example, SSH changes the type of the sudo terminal manually when you log in using Linux library function, and then you need to actually explicitly allow that to actually happen. All right, type member rule. This one is even more exotic. I hardly ever use that. Enables us to specify whether a process with a specified existing type security identifier can make the specified existing type security identifier of specified objects a member of other specified existing type security identifiers. This is laughable. So, used by SC Linux aware applications for polyinstantiation. I'm not going to go into polyinstantiation, but it's basically file system namespacing, I guess. And the keyword is type member, and here basically we're telling SC Linux that the user tempt is a member of the tempt dir for SSH, where the SSHD underscore T type is the type of the process in the source. I'm not going to go into this stuff, because if you want to learn that in detail, then just try it out and play with it, and by that time you're probably an expert. I hardly ever use this. It's just a statement that was basically implemented just for one functionality, and that's another one, type bounds, which we get into later. It's just implemented for just one very exotic use case. Anyways, requirements are type statements because the types must be existing types that you use in this statement. TE rules, not sure why that is required. Probably is required though in some one way or another. And then basically since the type members are used by as Linux aware applications, these applications call the AVC compute member and the security compute member as Linux library functions. So without those functions, those rules don't make any sense because the membership actually happens using those functions, and we're just allowing it with this rule. We're allowing it to happen with that rule. Okay, so here's that type bounce rule. It's another very exotic rule that was implemented pretty recently, policy 24, I guess. And it enables us to define a hierarchical relationship between specified existing process type security identifiers, where the bounded specified existing type security identifier cannot have more permissions than the bounding existing type security identifier. So this is used by as Linux aware multi-threaded applications that use dynamic transitions. So with the issue with multi-threaded applications is that, well, they have multi-threads and they don't actually execute a file to create a thread. They just fork a thread, I guess, or I don't know the technical details, but anyways, one issue with that is that they share the same memory. The threads share the same memory of the parent. So if you want to basically confine a thread, if you want to basically enforce integrity on a thread, then the permissions of a thread cannot exceed the permissions of the parent. And that's why the type bounds statement is used. So and it's used, the only instance where it's where I know it's used is for mod as Linux. Mod as Linux is a module for Apache that basically allows you to use as Linux to assign identifiers to threads based on which virtual host is accessed or which user authenticates using simple out or some Apache authentication scheme. But since these threads are basically all children of the main HTTP threads, we must make sure that these threads, these child threads, do not exceed the permissions of the main HTTP threads, the Apache thread. I guess. So the type bound statement is basically to make that create that rule that says, okay, the child thread cannot never exceed the main web server thread, or the main parent, so to speak. So yeah, that's basically some security, because else if that wouldn't be implemented, then there would be problems where the child could basically mess with the parent, I guess, in one way or another. So anyways, prerequisites are type statements, because the types used must be existing types, so you must declare them first. Access vector rules, I can't actually give a good example, but there's probably some access vector rules, but you'll see that once you actually implement it, that you'll see it if there's some prerequisites. The role-based access control statement of the role-based role statement. Yeah, so the role must be allowed, must be associated to the type, to the process type. That's obvious, because well, there's always a combination of a role identifier and a type security identifier. So the role security identifier must be associated to the type security identifier. And then the setcon as a Linux library function is probably also a prerequisite, because these dynamic type transitions happen using the setcon function. So basically the application must be as Linux aware, must call the setconf function to actually change the security context of the child manually using a dynamic transition. So, and then you actually allow that with the type bounce, I guess, statement. Type bounce rule, actually, it's not a statement. All right. Access vector rules. It's type enforcement rules, access vector rules. Enables us to specify how a specified existing type security identifier can interact with or operate on specified existing process or object type security identifiers respectively. So here are some keywords. Allow, don't audit, and audit allow. And there's even more, never allow, but I didn't mention that. But anyways, the don't audit keyword enables us to specify to silently deny a specified event. So basically deny it, but don't log the denial of that event. That's where you use the don't audit keyword. The audit allow keyword enables us to specify to verbosely grant a specified event. So to grant it, to allow it, an event, specified event, and to also log it so that you can actually see that it was actually that the event actually occurred and was allowed. So here are some actual examples of access vector rules, which are very common rules that anyone with that use SE Linux a little bit probably seen it. So some access vector rule, here you have a rule where you basically tell SE Linux to allow a process with a process type of user T to actually open get attribute and read directories and files with type etc underscore T. So you'll just allow it, just say okay, if user T, if a process with user T type opens, gets attributes of reads directories and files with type etc T, then just allow it. Here's another one, don't audit user underscore types shadow underscore T file open get attribute and read. So here it says deny it, but don't log the denial when any type security identifier that is associated to the user type's security attribute identifier tries to open get attribute or read files with the shadow underscore T type security identifier. So it's a combination of a bunch of things. So here we actually use a type attribute security identifier to make that rule apply to not just a single type but to a group of types. So don't audit it, so deny it and don't log the event, so it will be silently denied. You won't see any trace of it being blocked unless you load the policy without the don't audit rules enclosed, but I'll discuss that later. Anyways, the last example uses the audit allow keyword. So here basically it tells us Linux, okay, allow the password underscore T type process to write to the shadow underscore T type file, and also show me that when that happens, when it's allowed to do that. So that can be used for audit purposes if you want to see when someone when the password type process writes to the shadow type file, then just use the audit allow rule and it'll allow it, and also log the grant so you can see that when it happens. So these are the access vector rules. Those are the most common rules, I guess, and they're really self-explanatory. So you have this interaction or this operation, and there's always a source and a target, so that you can see here the source is the user T and the target is etc T. The source is user types, the target is shadow T, the source is password T, and the target is shadow T. And sources are always active entities, because active entities operate or interact, whereas passive entities, they don't interact. Passive entities get operated on by active entities. So that's really some concept that you might wanna keep in mind. All right, so on to the next. MLS statements, sensitivity statement. So basically enables us to declare sensitivity security identifiers and optionally associate local existing allies sensitivity security identifiers to sensitivity security identifiers. So keywords, sensitivity and allies. So basically this first example just declares a sensitivity of S0. And the second one basically declares the sensitivity of S0 and associates the existing low sensitivity sensitivity identifier to the S0 security identifier. Allies is it. And you won't use this much, if any, if at all. Category statements, well, the same idea as sensitivity statements. Enables us to declare category security identifiers and to optionally associate local existing alias category security identifiers to category security identifiers. Keywords, category alias. So here we declare a category of category 0, C0, and here we do the same, but we also associate an existing category, or actually alias an existing category identifier to the C0 category that's declared. You'll probably also don't use that. Level statements, or an MLS statement, enables us to combine specified existing sensitivity security identifiers and specified existing category security identifiers into a security level. So yeah, this basically so security level, I explained that in the previous slides, is basically a combination of categories and sensitivities. Yeah, and this basically this level statement allows the combination of the two, I guess. So here you have the keyword is level, so here you have an example level S0 sensitivity with the range of category 0 to category 1023, and that makes it a valid combination, I guess. This makes it a valid combination, I guess. You won't use that unless you are going to write policy from scratch. MLS statement, the dominant statement. When more than one sensitivity security identifier is declared, then a dominant statement is required to define the hierarchy between existing sensitivity security identifiers. So I explained that where you have basically these to enforce confidentiality, you have basically the various sensitivities, and you have high sensitivities and low sensitivities. So the dominant statement is used to define the hierarchy. So in this case, in this example, and let's just discuss the keyword first. The keyword is dominance. So in this statement, we're basically creating a hierarchy between the two sensitivities. We're just saying, okay, S0 is the low, the lower sensitivity in the hierarchy, where S1 is the higher sensitivity in the hierarchy. If we would basically turn them around, then we would basically say that S1 is the lower sensitivity and S0 is the higher sensitivity. But so that's basically, we're basically specifying the hierarchy of the two sensitivities that are used in this example. All right, MLS rules, range transition rule. So again, this is a transition rule. We should probably split that up in process range transition rules and object range transition rules. So this is the process range transition rule. Enables us to specify automatic range transition from one existing range to another when the process executes a file with a specified existing type security identifier. So process range transitions happen on exec, just like domain type transitions and role transitions. The executable file must reside on a file system mounted without the no SUID option, because no SUID option breaks the transitions. Keyword range transition. So in this example, we declare, we tell SELinux to range transition if the source process has a process type identifier of init t, and the target file to execute on, to transition on, has a type of audit the exact t, and then transition the range to this range S15, so the highest sensitivity, and with the full compartments, with all compartments, with all categories. So the transition happens on executing the audit the exact t type file, where the source is it process with type init t. Prerequisites: IBAC user statement, because I guess the range must be accessible, or must be associated to the user, to system U in this case, identity, user identity. And there's other stuff as well, obviously, because the role associated with the init t type must also be associated to the identity. Role statements, and that's where the role statement comes in. So yeah, the role that is associated to the init t type must be declared. TE statement, so yeah, to transition automatically range transition, you must be allowed to actually execute the RD exact t type file, because if you can't execute it, then the transition can't happen. And the MLS statement, because well, the MLS range, the MLS identifier must exist, and the level statement, I guess, because the level level must be valid, and stuff like that. So a lot of prerequisites, and well, this is something that you might actually use in practice on MCS systems and MLS systems. Okay, so the object range transition. So this is for objects, passive entities. Enhancement of range transition rule introduced with policy version 24. So initially there was only a process range transition, but later on the range transition rule was enhanced with the object range transition rule, or yeah, with the where you can actually use transition on objects. So enables us to specify automatic range transition from one existing range to another when the process creates a specified object in a directory with a specified existing type security identifier. So object range transition happen on create, just like file type transitions. Keywords range transition. So in this example here, we tell SE Linux that if a process with a process type of init underscore t creates a file in a directory with etc underscore t type, then range transition to system high with all categories to S15 colon C0 dot C1024. I haven't actually seen this in action, so I don't think you'll use it often, but it can be handy for initial labeling of devices that must be protected, so that data cannot be information cannot be leaked using those devices or something like that. Anyways, prerequisites: IBAC statement, because I guess these, I'm not sure, but probably due to role-based access control, because the init t is associated to some role, and that role must be associated to the user identity identifier, I guess. Type enforcement, yeah, because well, the creation happens on init dir with type etc t, so that must be allowed, and the creation of the file must be allowed, because the transition happens on creation. Can't create the file, then you can't transition on create either. Oh, and actually the types must be declared, so the type statement is required, because the etc type must exist and the init type must exist, so that's why the prerequisites are the type statements. And then an MLS statement, because, well, the sensitivity must exist, the categories must exist, and the level must be there. Okay, so here's a module statement. So enables us to declare a policy module, expects a module name and a module version, requirement for loadable policy modules. So back in the old days, the policy was monolithic, was a single file where all the rules were specified. But later on, the policy was made to support modular policy. So basically, it allowed you to create a new policy module and just install that and make the policy modular. So anyways, the policy module declaration is, or its statement actually, is required to declare a policy module. So if you declare a new policy module, then you'll use this statement. The keyword is module, and expects a module name, so you can insert a module name here, and then a module version 1.0, I guess. And that's basically on top of every policy module, you'll start with a module statement. Phew! Okay, so policy constraints. This is another one. Policy constraints allow for additional constraints that can override previously discussed policy rules with further restrictions. So these policy constraints are used to override previously discussed policy rules with further restrictions. Policy constraints cannot be specified in loadable policy modules. So this is really something modular, or something that you have to specify in the base module. However, that doesn't mean that you can't, that since you can't create policy constraint rules, that you can't actually hook your policy into a policy that heavily uses policy constraints. That is possible, because often existing attribute security identifiers are used in existing policy constraint rules. So since you can actually use attribute security identifiers in loadable policy modules, you can actually hook into the existing policy constraint rules. You just can't create new policy constraint rules, but you can actually make sure that your policy works with existing constraint rules. So this allows us to work with existing policy constraints from loadable policy modules by associating existing attribute security identifiers to security identifiers. So that's just one thing to note there. So the constraint statements and expressions in a nutshell, because we need to know a little bit about them. Constraint statements enable us to specify the access vectors to further constrain. So not additionally constrain, further constrain. So on top of the normal rules that we discussed previously, it's an additional further constraint. So keywords constrain, MLS constrain, MLS validate trends. Expressions enable us to specify conditions. So there are some operators, equals, doesn't equal, and an or. Those are the operators that you can use. MLS specific operators are equal, DOM, DOM by, and incomp, whatever that means. I don't know that. So here's how some constrain statement and expression combination looks like. So here you have a keyword, which can be either constrain, MLS constrain, or MLS validate constrain. And then you specify the access vectors to constrain. So it could be, for example, file read, and then the expressions, which can be specified using equals, doesn't equal, and or equal, blah blah. So yeah, the next slide goes a little bit deeper in that with an example. So here you have an example constraint. So here you constrain the file create, relabel, relabel to, and relabel from. So it says, okay, constrain it but not if the identity of the source is the same as the identity of the target. So if the identity in the security context of a source in a operation is the same as the identity in the target security context of an operation, then don't constrain the creation of file or relabeling of file. Or if the type has the can change object identity security attributes, type attribute security identifier assigned. So that's basically a rule. So here it's what it says. Additionally, so on top of the normal rules that we already used in previously, you can additionally specify that the file can only be created and relabeled if the following conditions are met. And then identity security identifier of source process must be equivalent to that of the identity security identifier of the target, or type security identifier of the source process is associated to the existing type existing type attribute security identifier called can change object identity. So yeah, it's not ASI Linux 101, but it's certainly something you need to be aware of, and you need to be able to how to read it. So this is just a very simple example, and you can look back at that and then just compare that to some of the more complex constraint statements and expressions, and then see if you can make sense out of it and just try it out, I guess. But it's basically not that often used. All right, so here's that expression further. This is actually a conditional policy, and that's basically subdivided in expressions and statements, I guess. So policy, conditional policy? Yeah, conditional policy is policy that is enabled or disabled if a specified condition is met. So for example, if a specified Boolean declaration is toggled to true or false, respectively, then if condition, then do this, or then this applies, or else, or if the condition is not met, do that. So if, and that's basically respectively. So if this is the true one, the first expression is for if the declaration is toggled to true, and the second is if the Boolean declaration is toggled to false. So then you have the else, but you can also do a true and false in one, of course, I guess. Or actually, that should be possible, I guess. And then there's a note, there are limits to what we can make conditional. So, but I'm probably going to show you an example in the next slide. So here's the Boolean statement. So we just discussed the Boolean expression, and here's the Boolean statement. Enables us to declare Booleans, or Boolean identifiers, I guess. Boolean security identifiers. Expects a Boolean name and a Boolean default state. So this is a requirement for conditional policy in loadable policy modules. So the keyword is bool, so to declare a new Boolean identifier and set the state to true by default, you'll do bool my boolean true, and if you want to declare a new Boolean value and set the state to false by default, then it's bool my boolean false. State of existing Booleans can be toggled manually with the toggle seBool and set seBool and seManage commands. Okay, that's cool. And here, we don't have an example of a Boolean, of a combination of a Boolean expression and a Boolean declaration, unfortunately. Maybe later. All right, so here's what a new concept called require, which is basically something that is specific to modular policy. It's a, I guess, a keyword that was implemented to deal with the dependency issues that arise with from modular policy. Anyways, include specified existing security identifiers, Boolean identifiers, access factors to our policy module. So if you want to use existing external security identifiers or Boolean identifiers or access factors, then you need to require them, import them, include them before you can actually use them. Enables us to use resources that are external to our policy module. So yeah, it's basically the same as I guess functions, libraries and functions and stuff like that, where you basically, if you want to use a function, then you first need to import it. So it deals with dependency issues of modular policy. So here's an example. Here you basically require some external type called my other type T, and some external attribute, my other type attribute, and some external access factors, file get attribute read open, and some external Boolean statement, my bool. So here you have optional policy. This is also something that's related to a modular policy. So policy that is enabled or disabled if prerequisites are met or if not met, respectively. So it deals with dependency issues of modular policies, because if you have like separate policy modules, then one policy module may depend on another, because if you basically require a type from an external module, and use that type in your module, then you actually require, then you depend on that. An optional policy is a, a keyword that can be used to wrap optional identifiers, external identifiers, so that the compiler doesn't choke if any of those identifiers or access factors are not currently available. So it just says, okay, use them if they exist, and if they don't exist, then don't use them. So here we have an example with a bunch of stuff that we discussed earlier. First, we basically declare a policy module with the module statement. Then we basically declare a type attribute with the attribute statement. Type attribute statement or the attribute statement, and then we basically declare a type myapp underscore t, and then associate the myapp's type attribute to the myapp underscore t type, and then we basically create an optional block which is opened with the brace and closed with the brace. And then inside there we import some external types that are not declared in this module, but that we need to use to specify a rule that we want to specify. So we're basically importing, requiring the my other type T, which is declared in some other external module. And then we importing some classes, some access factor. And then we actually write the rule inside the optional block that says, tells us Linux, okay, allow all the types that have that are associated to the my apps type attribute to actually read get attribute and open files that are labeled with the my other type files, but only do that if those types are available. If they're not available, then scratch this whole rule, then it does this whole block doesn't apply if any of this stuff is not available. But still, the remainder of the rules outside of the block will still apply. So it's a way to deal with dependencies. Because if you wouldn't do this, then you wouldn't be able to install, to remove a module if it would depend on others, because it would basically fail and say, okay, yeah, but the identifier used in this module is required by another module, so I can't deinstall it. And this allows you to just deinstall it, and then the policy inside this block will just no longer apply. So yeah, this is basically all you need to know about the ESLinux policy language, and this is just the theory. Later on, we'll actually put this in practice, because, well, there's also a workflow that you need to know to actually be able to effectively use these rules. But yeah, these are basically the rules that you need to know. And just for reference, this is just a high level overview. Later on, you can just look back and find and put the pieces together, I guess. So yeah, that concludes this chapter.